The first one is for those of you that are interested in chem engine pharmaceuticals, there's a seminar on Thursday. So I don't know if you're aware of the usual graduate student seminar on Thursday in chemical engineering at Chem 326H. And they're at 10:30 on Thursday. It's not just for graduates, but anyone can attend them. So one of the chem students from my master's is now a senior position in Glasgow State Point. Going to be speaking on change and pharmaceuticals. So that's an area you want to get into. It might be worth going to speak to speak after, because I know that he has a ton of different projects. And the tools from this course he uses extensively in his work. Secondly, I've been working over the midterm break period. I've been making a little website for the grades, which you can log in with your student number, and then it will email your passcode back to your McMaster.ca email address. And once you log in, you can go see all your grades for this course. Like, you can see all your assignments and the midterm, and it's broken down question by question, so you can see how you performed, and then you can see also how the class performed, and see where you maybe have a question. So that would be our 5 minutes. I'm just working on all the information. And then lastly, on this page, there's a little project coming up next week for the design of experiments section. So the design of experiments section of this course is 3 weeks long, and there's a 10% project for it. It's not a big project at all. It's 4 or 5 pages at most. And you'll have over 3 to 4 weeks to do it. But I'm just letting you know now, I'll be putting up on the website a list of topics. You can choose any topic you like, but I'll be showing you some sort of topics that are possible. And then during the DOE section of the course, you can be thinking about your project you're working on at the moment. And then will be sometime later this term. I haven't fixed it yet. Okay, so also about the course evaluation, just some feedback from my side. I really appreciated everyone's comments. The main problem, of course, was the assignment load being too heavy, which I knew kind of like 3rd week into the class. I had a lot of feedback already from outside the course evaluation. So the assignment load is definitely going to be lighter. There'll still be as many questions, it's just you won't have to hand them away. So there may be like 7 questions, and you only need to hand it away. Then also the pace of the class, I'm happy with that most of you said it's about right. Regarding PDF notes, there were a few comments there that they're not synchronized with the slides. So in today's class, you'll see I'll put the section numbers in the top corner of every slide. Follow a bit more closely. And then some people said that they're a bit wordy. Just some comments on that. When I was planning for the course in November, December, I was just going to do slides, and that was going to be the handout. This is statistics. It's a mathematical topic. It's very precise. There needs to be a lot of description to make sure that it's clear. You can't just put equations and bullet points. There's a lot more that goes with the interpretations than just bullet points. So I will keep going though with the slightly wordy PDF handouts, but then these slides are also available for you. So if you like the shorter form, then you can use the overhead projector slides. Okay. Then regarding the midterm results, there's the averages for the whole midterm. This includes the written and the take-home portion. So 15% for midterm written, 15% for take-home is the breakdown, so it adds up to 30% of this course is graded. I was happy with the results. The average is pretty high, around 90%. This grade is about okay. There's a few people at the bottom end of the tail, but it's normally distributed, it's happy. I'm happy with the overall performance. Okay, some of you did experience a very heavy written midterm, and that shows in the results for the written part. Oh, sorry, did I go to the table? Okay, there's the written part. Big spread. That's all. That's my major comment. The big spread. So this kind of showed whether you understood the material or not. Being open book, it was not an opportunity to try and find where to answer the questions. You had to know the material before the exam. Conversely, if you did well in the take-home midterm, you probably did well in the written midterm because you used that as a preparation step. But a lot of you probably didn't contribute to your group's written midterm. So there's marks where people get 120% for the written midterm and then got 40% for the 120 for the take-home and 40% for the written. So people that have big gaps between the two midterm components need to be catching up seriously. Don't allow the other people in the group to kind of carry your grade because it's going to eventually come back to you. Just on the take-home, obviously those grades were just phenomenal. Everyone answered all the extra questions, pretty much the average grade, 120%. Most people scored between 100 and 140. Very few at take-home. So I was really happy with the level of effort for the take-home. Like I said, with the written, if your written grade is very different from your take-home grade, just make sure you understand the concepts, because this is a course where the concepts matter more than the numbers. The take-home is for you to show me that you can get the numbers. The written midterm, a lot of you threw marks away by not answering the interpret the result part. You kind of got the answer, but never interpreted what it meant. So just pay careful attention to the wording of the questions. So I'll hand out the midterm sometime in the break. Okay. Any questions before we go on to a recap of the material? Okay, so last week, I'm just going to review a bit of last week's stuff and then we'll go on quite quickly to the re-section. The last class, rather, we were looking at this linear model of the form beta naught plus beta 1x plus an error. So this is our hypothesized model, and then we use some form of optimization problem or some sort of grid search technique, whichever approach you prefer, to compute an estimate of beta 0 and beta 1, and we'll call those B0 and B1. So these letters are for the primitive Roman numerals of for the mathematical characters of the estimate. In particular, if you solve using an optimization approach where you're minimizing the sum of squares, remember there's other objective functions you could use. You could minimize the sum of the median error, or any sort of other useful objective function could be used. But if you use the sum of squares, then you will calculate that B0 is that form and B1 is that form. We pointed out that the numerator of B1 is actually the covariance between x and y. So if you look at that form of covariance, it's x minus the mean times y minus the mean. So the numerator of the beta of the b1 coefficient kind of gives you an indication of the covariance between the x and y vector. Then the standard error is a number that we use to judge the model's performance. Assuming that that the residuals are normally distributed, the standard error can be interpreted like a standard deviation of the residuals. So the sum of squares of the errors divided by the degrees of freedom, and take the square root of that. And that's often what I use to judge a model. I compare the standard error against the range of the y values. So if my y's range from 0 to 100, and my standard error is plus or minus 3, I'm feeling pretty confident that this model's doing a good job. I don't usually look at the r square. That actually can be quite meaningless, as I showed up. The assumptions then that we have to make to interpret the model after we fit the model, now we want to look at interpreting what it means. We have to make these six assumptions, and we went through them quite quickly in the last class, and we'll focus a lot on them today. We assume the model is linear, that we correctly identify that our system is linear, and so the model is linear. The variance of y is constant at all levels of x. We'll talk about that again coming up soon. That the errors are normally distributed, that each error is independent of the other. And I mentioned last time that that's often violated in engineering type processes because we sample our system sequentially in time, but sample now and the sample the next one has some relationship to each other. So we don't always have independence, and I'll focus on this topic quite a bit today. Common assumption that the x's are fixed, And then lastly, that the y's are independent of each other. This assumption 6 falls naturally out of assumption 4 if the model is linear. Then just the error from the error being independent means that the y's are independent as well. Then we've already seen the standard error over here in the last line. The variance of the errors is the standard error. And it's used to calculate the variability of the two coefficients, B0 and B1. So standard error appears in there and appears in this equation. And we'll look at this a bit more today, but usually we're only interested in the variance of the slope. The intercept is not often of great interest to us. The one reason for that is often the intercept is far away from where we're building data. We may be building the data in terms of x between, say, 100 and 300 might be the range of our x's. So we're really not interested in what the model means at x equals 0. So often we just disregard the slope, the intercept, B0. We focus only on the intercept. Okay, so now we're going to continue on a bit with the notes. That this is now material that you've not seen from the last class. So page 19, we had last time that if you predict a new y value, so we showed last time if you predict a new y value y hat, we just take our new x nu, multiply by b1, add b0 to it, and we get our prediction of y hat. Now, given that we've interpreted the standard error to be kind of a standard deviation of the residuals, you might assume quite adequately in most cases that the error of your new prediction, so you've made this prediction of y, the error of that prediction is, say, plus or minus 2 of these standard errors. Because, as we've said, standard error can be interpreted as a standard deviation, plus or minus 2 sigma, or plus or minus 2 standard deviations, would cover about 95% of your range. So it's common to use 2 standard deviations. 3 standard deviations is really a strong error bound, but let's use 2 standard deviations, covering 95% of the data. So we just say, I make a prediction, y hat equals, say, 79. I know my standard error is 5, so 79 plus 10 or 79 minus 10 might be the range of my prediction of y hat. Here I illustrated on this example. We bring in our cut off the x-axis, but we bring in a new x, bring it up to this line, that's our prediction slope of y hat, and up 2 standard errors or down 2 standard errors would kind of capture the region of variance. And here there's 50 data points, so this being 95% confidence levels, or 95% bounded by SE, that says we expect 5 out of 100 data points to lie outside the limits, 2.5 data points out of 50. So there's 50 data points here, there's 1-2 data points kind of beyond those lines. So it makes kind of sense that way. But there's a tiny problem with this. So back when I was kind of deriving these equations myself, I was saying, well, I'm going to try to do this without the textbook and see how far I get. So this is kind of what I came up with. And then I opened the book and said, no, I'm wrong. What did I do wrong? Like, I basically assume that when we bring in a new x, it's measured without error, then we predict y. But the problem is I'm not taking into account the fact that b1 and b0 also have error. So they have error, that error propagates when you make the prediction of y. You can't just add on the residual error to the end. You also have to take into account that b0 and b1 have error over here. So b0 has a sort of error measured with that variance, and b1 has error measured with that variance. So using mathematical propagation of error or some sort of other tool, you can derive the correct form for the variance in a new prediction of y. So this is the y hat variance. So making a prediction of the new y, that variability will be given by that sort of form of variance. That's interesting because it shows, well, let's just go back into this case. This I said earlier that the 2 plus or minus 2 standard errors works generally well. But the problem is, unfortunately, I really shouldn't have done this. I've cut off the x-axis. I think it went from, say, 5 to 20. If I bring in a new y at 40, way out over here, this is telling me my prediction is still plus or minus 2 standard errors. For new x coming in way outside the region where the model was built. Okay? So that's obviously wrong. Bringing in a new x over here, I expect the error for the prediction of y to be much higher for an x that's way outside the region where the model was built. Okay? So that's why another reason why that's kind of a naive estimate of what the prediction of y hat is. If you look at this form, the correct form of predicting the error for y, it says that our new x coming in, our new xi, it's subtracted from the mean of the x. So the mean x would be some point over here, say maybe around 10. If we bring in a new x way out over here, that numerator term is going to be large. So it's going to inflate the variance prediction of y hat. So in fact, if you plot this form of the variability after, and there's an example in the notes that we can work through, you'll see that it has a quadratic shape. This is probably not the best illustration of it over this range, but you can start to see a kind of curvature in those prediction intervals. So we'll call this a prediction interval, the region bounded by the gray lines. So there's a curvature and they flare out up and open out towards as you get further and further away from the model center, which I've marked by hashes. So at the model center, x bar, is where you get the smallest prediction error. So you plug in x bar, that numerator term is zero. So at x bar, your prediction error is only 1 plus 1 over n times the standard error. So that's the lowest prediction error is right at the center of the model. That makes intuitive sense. As you start moving away from the center, so you either go more and more negative away from that star point, you get negative or you get positive, then that error really opens up. Okay? So work through the example in the data set, the example in your notes, which will step you through the procedure to calculate what the prediction error is for a new one. That is in fact already from the notes from the last class. That was already printed out there. But we never got a chance to cover it. Okay. So the notes now, investigating a linear model, this is section 10. This is totally new notes that we've not had before. So this is now from the point where we've built our linear model. Now we want to go investigate these sorts of topics. How do we transform the data and fit non-linearity? We'll be looking at things like leverage and outliers. We'll be extending to multiple linear regression, and then we'll be looking at some concepts regarding training and testing data. Okay, and what we'll be working with probably is the residuals in this class. The residuals, it's actually quite surprising. It's a little bit counterintuitive. Why do the residuals contain all the information? The residuals are really the uninteresting things, usually. They contain the unmodeled components of our data. But in fact, the residuals are the perfect tool to use to evaluate what's gone wrong with our model. And this is common to all areas of data mining or data analysis. We use the residuals to really learn more about how our model is performing. Okay, so the first assumption was normally distributed errors. And I'm going to just pick at all of those assumptions that I listed earlier, normally distributed errors, non-constant variance, linearity, and we're going to see how can you detect when that assumption is met. We're going to show what you can do about it if it's not met, and how do you know when it is met. So in all these next few slides, they're going to have that common theme, how to detect the problem and how to fix it. Okay, so we've assumed that our errors are normally distributed. What is the problem if they're not normally distributed? Well, the errors, if they've got really long tails, either on the low end or at the high end, they inflate the standard error. So the standard error, remember, is just the sum of squares of the residuals. So if you've got really long tails, very negative or very large positive residuals, now you're squaring that, so it's the sum of the squares, SE really gets inflated. What is that? Why is that a problem? Well, we know that the term like the variance on D1 is a function of SE. So it's sitting there right in the numerator. If SE is inflated, then the variance of D1 is inflated. And the square root of this, the square root of SE squared D1, or just the standard error of D1, is what we use to calculate the confidence interval for D1. Remember? We said that beta 1 divided by, D1 minus beta 1 divided by the standard error of D1, that's the Z value for D1, and then we, from that we form the confidence interval for beta 1. So if our variance here is inflated, then that confidence interval gets inflated. The problem with that is that you might have a term that really is important, and then it tells you, well, hang on, no, the slope is really not important at all. So you could get the totally wrong interpretation from inflated residuals. Okay, so that's the issue with non-normal residuals, and we detect it by using a QQ plot. That's standard by now in the course. We know that it needs to match a 45-degree line. My only caution here is that a histogram is helpful, but don't plot the residuals in time order and try to see if they're normal or not. That's probably useless. As in a previous class, remember, I showed you a chart of some data and I asked you, is this normally distributed? 9 times out of 10, people will always estimate incorrectly. Use a QQ plot to verify if something is normal or not. Don't try to look at the data in time order. Okay, so then dealing with it, I'll come back to that in a minute. I'll just show you a quick example here. So here is a data set where we're trying to predict the price of a used vehicle using only the mileage on the odometer. So I fit the data to a model that says the beta 1 coefficient is for the mileage. From that I try and predict the vehicle sales price. What would be the coefficient of B1 for model like that? So Y is equal to dollars plus, say, B0 plus B1 X1, where X1 is the mileage on the car. Beta 1's coefficient.
Dollars per mile.
Yeah, and what sign? What sign?
Negative.
So more miles, the lower the price. But you can see here, then after the residuals have been calculated from that model, from filling at B1, there's a number, well, firstly, it's totally non-normal. But then there's this group of cars out here, and you go investigate that. Well, those are from the Cadillac convertible. So those cluster of cars are influencing the model. They're definitely creating large residuals, in the order of $40,000. So the model is predicting an error that's off by $40,000 for those few observations in the data set. Well, you can go remove it and then refit the model, and you get something that's a little closer to normality, but not really normal, but it's closer than it was before. Of course, now your model is totally unable to work with Cadillac convertibles, but that's the price we pay for getting a lower standard error. So we've gone from $9,700 to $8,600, and our coefficient has changed slightly. So here, where we had a negative, so that says for every additional kilometer on the car, we get 17 cents less for the sales price. Well, that's changed down to 15 cents. And then you can verify that this confidence interval has shrunk as well because the standard error is now. And then you can go try something else now to try and make those residuals more normal looking. Some of the other things you can go try are, well, the first one, very important to first investigate why you're removing the eyebrows. But other things you can go try is to make a transformation of the y variable, or you can go add additional terms to the model. So those are the sorts of topics we're going to cover in the rest of the class today. Here's an example of a transformation. This is just a fictitious data set to illustrate the point. It doesn't have any physical meaning. But what I'm doing here is I'm predicting a y from a x. And then after showing the residuals plot, I see there's this tail. What that says is that there's a piece of the residuals that have got really large positive errors. So the model works fine over most of the region. Even on the negative tails, it works okay. But on the positive residuals, there's this region where the residuals are non-normal. And that's going to inflate the standard error. One thing to try is a transformation. So here I'm now predicting the square root of y rather to x. So my model is of the form where I first make the square root of y and then u1 plus it. So in R, you still use the normal tool in the software, but you just give it the square root of the y values. You can do that for the x values as well. Say you could fit a model with y equals b0 plus b1 square root of x. So you can transform the variable to try and make the residuals look more normal. Okay, I'll move on to another assumption. This one is actually not too critical. This is the assumption of constant error. What that says is that the variance of the residuals is constant at any level in x. Okay? So even when you're operating at low levels of x or high levels of x, the variance of the residuals is roughly constant. So what we're looking for when we're plotting, say for example we want to plot the residuals on this axis, so the residuals are centered around 0, and I'm going to plot them against x, you're looking for and kind of fall into a band like that. Okay? If they were non-constant, you would see the variance increasing as x goes up, or decreasing. So a common example is that your ability to measure temperature accurately at moderate temperatures is okay. But the moment you move to higher and higher temperatures, the variability of the measurement gets larger. So you see something where it's kind of fanning out as x, in this case temperature, gets larger, the variability in that measurement gets bigger. So you can plot it against x, or you can plot it against y hat. This is another problem I have with the class. It's a small board space. So I know a few of you complained about that in the course evaluations, but I've asked and they're not able to do anything about it, pretty much. So we're kind of stuck with this. But it annoys me as much as it annoys you. So, we're plotting y hat against the residuals, and you're seeing that fanning out shape. Now, that's really not too big of a deal for most linear models. These squares is very robust to violations in these assumptions. But the point is that it's worthwhile looking at it, and then if it is critical to you, you can do something about it. And in this case, really the only thing you can do about it is to use what's called weighted least squares. So weighted least squares says, instead of just minimizing the sum of squares of the errors, you add a weight term in front of each error. So typically, wi is 1. For ordinary least squares, wi is 1 for all I. But what you could do for weighted least squares is you could use weights that go inversely proportional to the variance. So if you knew this was happening in the data, you would use weights of 1 down here, and then you would downweight the points over here. So you could then gradually move to a weight of, say, 0.5, and that would bring that in for you. But that's a topic that we're not going to cover in this course. There is, however, standard tools for this in R, where you can just provide this vector of weights, and it will then fit this model for you without you doing much extra work. But if you want to know more about it, I'm going to constantly refer to this book by Draper and Smith. It is on reserve in the library for those of you that are really interested in getting into a bit more of the details. And then you know that you've sorted out the problem when you get, you know, you get this sort of constant error over all the units of x, or plot x against, or y hat against the other units. The next topic here is independence of the data. This is actually a very serious assumption in terms of what it can do to the variance of SE. So independence is required according to the central limit theorem, and the central limit theorem was used to derive the standard error. Now, if your data is not independent, we typically say it's autocorrelated. By that I mean it's correlated to itself. That's what the word autocorrelated means. And you get autocorrelated data when you're sampling from a very slow moving process. So for example, you've got a very large reactor and you're measuring concentration from that reactor. Minute by minute, the concentration doesn't change too much. But day to day, those numbers are independent. But minute by minute, you don't have independent data. So in that case, you could then not use the minute by minute data, but then use a data point, one data point from each day, and use that to build the model. That would overcome the violation of the autocorrelation assumption. So that's one way we'll deal with it in the course. In fact, it's the only way we'll cover. The proper way to deal with autocorrelated data is to use a whole section of tools known as time series analysis. So time series analysis is not usually offered at the undergraduate level. It's not a complex topic, it's just it needs really like 6-7 classes of this duration to cover it properly. So in McMaster, it's a 700 level course, or it used to be a 700 level course for the grad students. It's not available at the undergraduate level. But I'm just putting it out there for you to know that that is really the only way to deal with autocorrelation and time dependencies within the data. The makeshift approach we'll use today comes from time series analysis, and I'll just talk a little bit about some time series analysis tools, particularly to detect autocorrelation. So to detect autocorrelation, the easiest way to do it is to just plot your residuals in time order. And because our eye is so good at picking out patterns, the human eye is phenomenal at picking out patterns in data, this is really the best way to see autocorrelation. So here you would look for things like slow moving drifts. As you can see here, the data moves slowly from the higher level to the lower level. You could look for things like rapid crisscrossing of the zero axis. So the residuals always being centered at zero, you could look for up and down, above and below movements of the residuals, or you could look for any sort of cyclical behavior. So there may be some sort of cycles over there. That immediately indicates you've got an autocorrelation problem. So here I'm just going to talk a little bit about how you can detect autocorrelation. If you don't want to just trust it to your eye, in fact, would you even say, for example, this data over here is autocorrelated? Does it look pretty much random to you? So, and this is a similar example to what I had spoken about earlier. In fact, there is some autocorrelation in this particular time series. It's very moderate. It's not nearly as much as, say, in that time series, which I showed earlier. This one over here, often people say this is also random looking, but this is not. This is very, very negatively autocorrelated, as you can see by the up and down, above and below. It's almost like over control. You're moving a little bit too much to the one side and then you compensate by going the opposite way, backwards and forwards. So this is the raw data down here in the bottom row, and then corresponding to each plot above that, I've drawn what the autocorrelation function looks like. this is why I don't want to go into time series analysis, because to describe what this autocorrelation is doing here is a long, tedious derivation. But all that you need to know is that in R, you just say ACF of Y. So if Y is your vector, or ACF of the residuals. So ACF, and then plug in the residuals over there. That would generate this plot for you. Okay. So in R, once you've got your model, you've got a model, dollar symbol, residuals. So residuals, and then put ACF around it. I think this is in the notes, so 2-3 pages, but we're going to get to it in a minute. That's fine. The point is that you use the ACF function to do the work for you. Now let's take a look at what this means. How do you interpret this graph at the top? What this tells you is the number of lags from sample to sample, which has a significant effect on each other. So let's take the middle case. At lag 0, the autocorrelation function is always 1. Because this current sample is 100% autocorrelated with itself. So at 0 lag, your autocorrelation function always returns the value of 1. But at lag 1, that says at sample k plus 1, has a relationship of, in this case it's around about 0.4, 0.3, 0.4, about a 30%, 40% relationship with the next sample. So sample at time step k has a 30-40% relationship with sample at k plus 1. That's how to read this plot. And then all the lags that are within the error bars over there are not significant. So you will always calculate a non-zero lag, but it's just so showing you that lags 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 20 are not significant. So this particular vector of data taken in time order has autocorrelation of 1 lag. So sample k is related only to sample k plus 1. But sample k is not got any relationship to sample k plus 2. Okay, so there's lag 1. So if you wanted to subsample this data to get independent data, you would just take every second data point. That's how you read this middle. So in this particular case, you would take sample 1, 3, 5, 7, up to 99. And then that new vector of reduced size would be independent. You can, of course, go repeat all the correlation on that new vector just to verify it, but it should be pretty much independent. This case over here, where there's a very, very strong relationship from one sample to the next, I mean, we don't even need to see the autocorrelation function to know that, but we can clearly see that there's a strong dependence from one sample to the next in the first part of the data. The autocorrelation function just merely verifies that for you and shows it extends out to about 16 lags. So in this case, you would just take every 17th or every 20th sample, just to be safe. And then those subsample data would be independent. And in the last case, we have negative autocorrelation. So you can see that, again, lag 0 is got a coefficient of 1, as it has to be. But then at lag 1, it has about negative 0.45. So it shows each sample has about negative 45% relationship to the previous one. And again, if you wanted to undo the autocorrelation there, you would take every second or every third sample. Anything beyond that significant lag would work, and then create independent data. Okay, so once you've figured out how many lags, you can then subsample accordingly and then work with the subsample data. Now, I've made a note there in the course notes there that to calculate the autocorrelation function properly, you need a really long string of data, well over 100 points. But if you're going to be subsampling from that data, you're going to need a lot of data anyway to begin with, and then go subsample from it. And then there's just another test, again, if you're really interested, Draper and Smith's book, we'll talk about the Durbin Watson test. Okay. Finally, just the other assumption is that of linearity. Just to talk a bit about this issue, you may or may not have heard the famous quotes, all models are useful, or something like that. Box came up with some quote, now it's slipped my mind. Anyway, the point is that a model should not be, that's not the gospel truth. Once you've built a model, it's there to be disproved. Take it with a grain of salt, it's only there to be of some use. It may not be a perfect representation of the truth. And we use that principle in many cases. So in this case, we've got a non-linearity in the system where we're relating x to y. There's some curvature. I think in this case, I've developed this with an exponential relationship. But within the region of 6 to 8, say that happened to be the area in which our process operated, we could get by with a linear model. So I've shown the linear model where I built that linear model only using the points marked the triangle, because that's the region where we're going to end up using the model. We know that it's a compromise, but short of going to fit a nonlinear model, we could probably be quite happy with the performance over that limited region, knowing that beyond 8 and below 6, the model is going to fall short. And we'll always probably get residuals that are negative or positive. But over a limited region, we can do pretty well. But how do you know that? I mean, we don't always know that ahead of time that there's nonlinearity in the system. So how can we detect when there is nonlinearity showing up? The easiest way is to plot x against the residuals and y hat, the fitted y. It's a little bit tiny here, but plot y hat against the residuals. Both of these plots will look identical, or if you just pick one of them, you don't need to do both. Why do they look identical? Well, y hat is just b0 plus b1 x1. So whether you plot the residual against y hat or you plot it against x1, one is a linear combination of the other. So you'll get always the same looking data. And you look for evidence of structure. So here we see that sort of quadratic structure, and that comes from how the points kind of are initially above the line, then below, and then above. So that hints at an appropriate transformation to make. You might then decide to then look at, say, a square root or a square root of x or a log of x or something that makes x kind of shrinks it in to then make that more have less structure there. So you detect your incorrect model specification. So we don't always know the truth that there's nonlinearity, but we've assumed a linear model. So when do we know we're wrong? By using these sorts of plots. What do we do to deal with it? Well, there's three ways. The first one is to do a full-blown nonlinear least squares, which, again, we're not covering in this course. It's four or five lectures of this duration to properly cover the mechanics of nonlinearity. Basically, you cover a little bit of it, actually, in your optimization course, those of you taking things 4G, because then you're fitting nonlinear functions, you're minimizing functions that are nonlinear. That is exactly what nonlinear least squares does, is it says, I'm hypothesizing, for example, that y is this nonlinear function of x, and then using the data, you can go minimize the sum of squares of the errors around that function. So instead of using y equals b0 plus b1x, you just plug in that new function. But now you're minimizing the nonlinear function, so your tools then from the optimization course could be used. A makeshift way you could do it here is just set up a grid. Let b1 go 10, 20, 30, 40, and b2 be those values there, and then set up a rectangular grid. B1's on the one side, B2's on the other side. And then for every point, for every combination of beta 1, beta 2, plug them into that equation. And then you use your x's and your y's that you've got, your known data. and then calculate the sum of squares of the errors of the objective function, and then just find the minimum. But of course that requires that you have a good feel for where that minimum might lie, that there's not going to be multiple solutions. There's all sorts of issues that come up there, and that's why you can see it's not covered in the course of this lecture, because those complexities are just take a lot of time to go through. So that's one way to deal with the property. The other way is to do what we've hinted at here already, is by making some sort of transformation of the data. So the general principle, either for the x or for the y, here I just showed for the x, is you take your original x and you move it to some sort of transformed x, and then you use that in your model instead. In particular, you can use powers of x. So x original to the power of p, so then you go 1, 1 and a half, instead of 5, 2 is the square of x. And what that will do is it will inflate large values of x. If you're going up the powers, you will just inflate large x's get larger. And that may be to compensate for your data. Or you do the opposite, where you go down the powers. You go 1 to 0 and 0.5, which is just a square root, a quarter, negative square root, or you just invert the data, or go even as far as a negative 2, which is the inverse of the square of x. And that does the opposite. That will just shrink large data points and expand small numbers. So small numbers get inflated, larger numbers get shrunk down by going down in power of roots. And then log kind of fits naturally into this progression over here. It approximates, at least in terms of severity of the transformation, the case when p is equal to 0. Okay, so that's the other way of dealing with it. It's an iterative approach. It's not going to tell you, certainly by looking at this plot over here, it doesn't point to which particular transformation. It just kind of hints at it, and you can go try several that you see their little key plots. That's the other method. And then lastly, this is quite common. You've probably seen this in your reactive design course before, where you just rearrange a first principles equation. So for example, in a distillation column, we know the temperature is inversely related to the log of the vapor pressure. So if you want to fit y equals d0 plus d1x, and knowing that theoretical model, you can then just use x as the inverse of the temperature. And this y should be not p, but it should be log of p. I think that's correct in the notes, I think it's correct in the slides. Just check the intersection 10.5 of the notes. But so the purpose is that you make a transformation of the raw data to match some known theoretical model. And in this case, how would you interpret the slope coefficient? Yeah, so the units are inverse of the temperature. But you kind of have to be a little careful now. Normally, say temperature was our x variable, then a 1 degree change in temperature shows you the change in vapor pressure. But now it's inverse, so you have to kind of work through what that means. It's not always obvious. So you lose a little bit of the interpretability, or not lose it, but you lose the ease of interpretability at the, but you do gain maybe a better fit to the data. Here's another case where y is this general variable p and variable q to the power x. So if you take logs on both sides, then your slope coefficient now is just log q. So you just take logs, your y variable is actually log y, you still use the raw x data, and then you're going to fit log q as your slope coefficient. Well, this one is quite common in engineering systems like Michaelis-Menten type reactions and so on, where you have your x in the denominator. So you just flip the whole model around, and then your slope coefficient V1 is then estimated as Q, your intercept is Q, and you have to fit Y in the value of Y in order to fit that according to the usual mechanism. Okay, so just a rearrangement of your first principle state, and then you look for no structure. So go back to these plots. You just keep doing that until you see no particular structure in the data. Okay, so I'm just going to summarize here, and then we will have a quick break. So section 11 shows these same steps with the corresponding coding R. So firstly, just plot your data. Fit your model, so we'll use this linear model where Y is described by variable X. Now, one thing you can do in R, and I'll have a tutorial up on the website in the next day or so, is it's quite nice when I say you have to do these transformations. You don't actually have to go first, you don't have to go, for example, say Y mu is equal to log Y, and then go linear model Y mu as described by X. You don't have to do that. You can directly just say linear model of log Y as described by X. And it will take care of all the work in between doing it. So I'll have a few examples of that on the website, of some shortcuts that you can do that. Anyway, at the end of it all, you get a model object in the R workspace, and you can look at the summary. And then here's maybe a new function that you've not seen before. I've had you up to now calculate by hand in the take-home and the written midterm the confidence intervals by hand. But there's a function called confint, and you just pass the models through that, and it will show you the 95% confidence interval for the slope coefficient and for the intercept. Once you get this, look at the model standard error from that summary instruction, and also look at and pay attention to the interpretation of the confidence interval. That's usually why we're building these models after all. Okay, you can visualize your predictions, just plotting Y against X. And then here I've shown the command for drawing sort of like a smooth version. I always like to superimpose a smoother on top of my data. But remember from the last class, we just covered it very briefly called the non-parametric smoother. It just shows an approximation of the relationship between X and Y. And then superimposed on top of that, you can just use this AB line function and pass it the model. It will extract from model the slope and intercept and draw that straight line on top of the data. And I'll just change the color to it. Okay, look at the QQ plots for the reveals. Are they normally distributed? And in the notes, I give a few more hints on what to do if they're not. Plot the residuals against the X, plot the residuals against time, plot the residuals against the fitted value. So these groups, group 5, 6, and 7, those are there to check non-constant error variance, whether there's linearity in the model, or whether there's sort of a time-related secret. So use the autocorrelation function as well with model dot residuals. So this pulls out the residual vector. You don't have to calculate Y minus Y hat. It's already calculated inside so if you call it model, here I called it model. So model, dollar residuals, we'll just pull out the residuals and then do the autocorrelation function on those residuals. In fact, model contains a whole lot of information. If you wanted, for example, the Y hats, you don't need to go extract the V0 and the V1 coefficients. You can just use the in R, you could just use the fact that there's a model dollar fitted dot values. That gives you the Y hat. So they call them fitted values in R. And it's a model dollar fitted dot values. And that's what you can use here for the ones. So plot the Y hats against the Ys. And you expect a 45-degree line. Okay, so let's take a 10 or so minute break here. Next section we're going to be looking at including more than one variable. So up to now, we've just been looking at the effect of a single variable x on y through the slope coefficient e1. But now we're going to introduce more than one x variable, and it really helps to have some matrix notation to do that. So I'll introduce that first. I'll show how the optimization problem is resolved. And then interpreting the model coefficients. In fact, when you've got more than one x variable, the interpretation of the model coefficient changes in a subtle way. So we'll talk a bit about that. Then we'll look at some integer variables. So the reason for including multiple variables in your model are that you improve your understanding. Firstly, take this case here where we've got reaction concentration, and we're using it to predict reaction rates, say, the y variable. And x2 is now the temperature. So we may already have a model with x1, the concentration, and use that to relate it to reaction rate. But by including the second variable of temperature, we can now improve our understanding beyond just the concentration effect, but then also add the temperature effect. So it's not just learning about our model that we may be enhancing, but also our predictive ability. We're improving our ability to make a prediction by including a second variable. So, for example, if we're predicting health index, like the last question in the exam, from temperature, we know that temperature is related to health index, so we may get some sort of model for that. But the predictions might be improved by adding the food flow rate. And then lastly, how do you handle things like integer variables, where maybe you know that mixing tank A has a better performance than mixing tank B? How do you include the fact that the model is done in mixing tank A and mixing tank B? Or the operator has an operator in the first shift and operators in the second shift might lead to changes in the y variable. How do you include the operator? Or the supplier, or the day of the week might be an important variable. So how do we quantify these integer variables and include them in the model? Okay. So on the notation here. Just a word about the notation. It makes it really a whole lot easier if we can remove the intercept term from the model. So I'm just going to show you how we can remove the intercept from the model. If there's no trick, it's just a mathematical step we often do to get rid of the intercept because it makes the rest of the derivation quite easy. So the way we do it, let's start with the basic model yi is equal to b0 plus b1 x1. b1 x1. And you know the mean. The mean is given by y bar equals b0 plus b1 x bar. And we know that this regression slope passes through the mean. Subtracting the one line from the other, you can write that equation. And that shows that if you now use yi minus y bar as your new y variable, and if you use x minus x bar as your new x variable, the intercept term drops out to zero, but you still get the same slope coefficient. In fact, in the assignment, you will prove this to yourself where you build three models, one where you just center the x, one where you center the y, and of course the uncentered version, and then you'll prove to yourself that you get the same slope coefficient, the same standard error. You get the identical model. The only difference is that in the one case your b0 is 0, and in the other case it's whatever it used to be. You can always recover b0. If you're interested, you can always recover b0 by using that second line. So there's nothing special here, we're just keep centering our data. So subtract the mean of x, subtract the mean of y, and we use that to build our model now. In fact, you probably won't even use it to build the model, you'll let r take care of all of that. We're only going to use this idea to derive the next step here. So that's why you won't see a b0 in this derivation. But what we do now is we say that this general model be given by y, and then we have k terms in the model. So we introduce k terms, x1, x2, up to xk, and we've got the k corresponding beta coefficients for those x's. So in a vector form, and you can write this out for the ith observation in that form or in vector notation, even more compactly as the last one there. So x transpose theta plus some sort of residual. And that x vector is 1 times k and the beta vector is k dot 1. So that's just for a single observation. Writing that equation n times, we can now go to a matrix form. So I'm just taking this previous equation here, x transpose theta over here, and I'm just rewriting, copy and paste this equation n times, 1, 2, 3 up to n, and then forming these matrices. So matrix X then represents that first column is variable 1, the second column is the second variable for each observation, up to k columns. There's a plus sign missing over here. So then x times b plus this residual vector e gives you your y. Okay, and I just noted the dimensionality of the various vectors and matrices over there. So nothing special here. In fact, you can do this for single variable regression. We'll just have one column of x, and it will still work. But now we're going to multiple x's, so when you minimize that objective function, it's now the sum of squares of the residuals is being minimized. So e transpose e means exactly the same thing. You can expand it out, y minus xb transpose y minus xb. And to solve that, you take partial derivatives with respect to each of the b's within vector b. Or you can do it in terms of vector, matrix algebra, so the partial of f with respect to b, set that equal to zero. And in the notes, I give a web-based reference of an excellent guidebook that shows how to solve these sorts of partial derivatives with respect to vectors. It's called the Matrix Cookbook. It's 30 odd pages of different formula that you can use. You can use one or more of those formula in the Matrix Cookbook to prove to yourself, though I don't expect you to, but you can prove to yourself then that the solution to this equation, where you set the partial derivatives to zero, is given by the standard equation that you've likely seen before, x transpose x inverse x transpose y. So that comes out in the same way we did for single variable regression, where we set that partial derivative of f with respect to b0 and b1, we set that into zero. With the vector case, with the multiple vector case, we get the same solution, b equals x transpose x inverse x transpose y. And in the same correspondence, you get that, well, let's just start with the third line, the standard error, is the sum of squares of the residuals divided by the degree of freedom. But what's new here is that the variance of b is given by x transpose x inverse times the standard error. Okay? And the expected value of b equals beta, that just tells you that the estimates that we make of b will approximate beta. So these are unbiased estimates. You're going to estimate beta centered on zero. There's no bias to the estimates. But that's really not an issue in this course. The main thing is the notation here that the variance of the b's is given by x transpose x inverse multiplied by the standard error. Now what I want you to take a look at just a second here is earlier we had for the single variable case that the variance of b1 is given by that. That's what we derived in the last part. If you compare this form of the equation to this equation number 2 up here, they're identical. Remember that the x's are being mean centered. So mean centering just says x minus x bar. So the x variable we're using is already centered. X transpose x inverse for a single x variable is just 1 divided by x transpose x for this denominator term here, multiplied by the standard error. So you can see that even for a single variable case, the matrix form gives you the same solution as we expect. And in the single variable case, remember we said, how can we decrease this variance? We said we can do it by adding more data points to our model. That made total intuitive sense. The more data you use to build your model, the lower the variance of your estimates. And secondly, by moving away from the model center, increase this denominator term, so you reduce the variance of D1. Why is that of interest? Well, we always are interested in decreasing the variance of our estimates because we want to know what B1, B2, BK are more precisely. So having that variance small is really in our favor. So those are two ways to do it. Okay, so here's a tiny example. I'm not going to ask you to work through it, but it's in your notes. I've given the, in your notes, in fact, you have the uncentered x and the uncentered y, and you already have in your notes the centered x and centered y. I just didn't put the raw data. I've just gone straight to the centered x and y. So we have two vectors, x1 and x2. And what's the relationship between them? Between x1 and x2. So when you see it in matrix form, the first column is in fact x1, the second column is x2. So variable 1 in the first column, variable 2 in the second column. You, and as you put out there, the signs swap around. So they're negatively correlated. As x1 goes up, x2 goes down. So there's some sort of relationship between our raw data, x, and there's also a relationship between x and y. What's the relationship between x1 and y? Positively correlated. And x2 and y? Okay, so simple stuff, but you see it actually quite nicely from the centered form, whereas in the raw data, it's a little harder to see, but it is still there. But in centered form, you really start to see it quite nicely, particularly here that the signs match exactly. But in general, as x1 increases, x2 decreases, and x1 is positively correlated to y, and x2 is negatively correlated to y. Okay. Now remember I said B is equal to x transpose x inverse x transpose y. That was what we found over here. Let's take a look at these two components that B is made of. The first one is x transpose x. Now, remember these data are centered. So when you calculate x transpose x, the first element means is what? If you just had to derive the first element in that matrix, you would have x1 transpose x1. Okay? So given that x is a centered, what does x1 transpose x1 mean? So x is centered about 0. We're asking what does x1 transpose x1 mean? So a lot of this course is not just about getting equations and formulas, but also understanding what they do. What would you interpret by that 55 element in the first entry of x transpose x?
Some of the x1 squared.
So some of the x1 squared, but it has a particular interpretation in this case because the x's are centered around 0. Exactly. It's related to the variance. So variance we would normally divide through by n. Get or n minus 1 to get the variance. But it's a scale, every term in fact in this matrix is scaled by n minus 1. So this 55 is directly proportional to the variance of x1. Similarly, the second term in the second, row 2, column 2, is the variance of x2. So x2 transpose x2. So that takes care of our two diagonal elements. If I had to draw x transpose x here, so x1 transpose x1 and x2 transpose x2. Now let's take a look at the off diagonals. What is the entry of the first row, second column? Let me go over here. So if x1 transpose x1 was in the first column, So this, recall this first vector over here, this first column is x1, this column is x2. So x transpose x. Symbolically, if I should put something here, it would be x1 transpose x2. And over here? Perfect. So, there, no surprise in that these two elements are identical. The off diagonals, say you had three columns of x, your off diagonals would always be symmetric. You need to really look at the upper triangle or the lower triangle of x transpose x to understand what's going on. So, because of that mirror image you get. So, what does x1 transpose x2 mean? What would you interpret that number to mean? Covariance, right? So if x1 transpose x1 is the variance, x1 transpose x2 is the covariance. So this element here is the covariance between the first and second variable. Now if the two variables are unrelated to each other, so in this case we only have two variables, if x1 was totally unrelated to x2, what would you expect the off-diagonal terms to be? Okay, zero. So x transpose x is a nice matrix to understand because it shows you in a very compact form quite a bit about the data. It shows you, firstly, the diagonal elements, how much variance there is in the raw x variables individually. So you look along the diagonal, x1, x2, x3, up to xk, and that gives you an indication of the size of that vector. That's what variance is. X1 transpose X1, if it's very large, that number, it indicates to you that there's a large degree of variance. That vector is spread out over a wide area. If you had to compare it, say, to X transpose X2, X2, X2 here is a bigger number than 55, you could infer that variable X2 spans a wider range of operation than X1. So by looking at your diagonals, you're getting an idea of the magnitude of the variable. So remember from geometry, the magnitude of a vector is really just the sum of squares of the elements in the vector. So this is the same thing. The sum of squares of the elements in the vector. It will give you an idea of the magnitude of the vector. And then the off diagonals give you some sort of indication of the relationship between the x's. Now x transpose y, let's take a look at that. It's just, so symbolically, the first entry would be, what did I write over here? The same way we did x transpose x, symbolically here it would be x1 transpose y and x2 transpose y. And the interpretation of that is, say for the first entry would be covariance again between x and y, x1 and y. So here we said earlier on, just by looking at the data, we noticed this positive relationship between x1 and y, and we noticed that x2 was negatively correlated to y. That's conveniently summarized here by the signs of those elements here. So we're seeing straight away that x1 is positive related to y, and x2 is negatively related to y. This is great because you can be given a large data set and then only have these matrices available, not the raw data, not even the plots of the raw data, and you can still tell quite a lot of what's going on about the system where the data came from originally. So it's no surprise that x transpose x and x transpose y, we're going to see them not in the design of experiment section, but in the related variables section where we're getting multiple variables. These two matrices are going to come up all the time. So make sure you understand the variance orientation as well. And in the latent variable section, we will always center our data. So in fact, it's the same thing here. We've centered our x to a. Okay, so x transpose x then, we can call it the scaled version of the covariances of the individual x's. The diagonal entry is always positive, the off diagonals are symmetrical and show the strength of the relationship between the two. And as you pointed out, really, uncorrelated x's have zeros and all factors, or close to zero. We won't always have exactly zero. Now, coming back to that term that the variance of the vector b is related to standard error times x transpose x inverse. So there's the x transpose x inverse. I'm not going to expect you to invert the matrix in an exam or so on. We'll always just use a computer to do that. The x transpose x inverse shows here, though, that the variance of b1 and the variance of b2 are not independent. The fact that we have non-zeros on that off diagonal indicates that the variances of b1 is related to the variance of b2, and vice versa. b2's variance depends on b1's variance. That's interesting. In fact, if x transpose x had zero off diagonals, so coming back to x transpose x, if the terms on the off diagonals were zero, it indicates that x1 and x2 are independent of each other. There's no effect. Then, of course, in x transpose x inverse, the off diagonals would also be zero. Okay? So that's one thing to note. Now, the fact that they're non-zero here indicates that one of the variance from B1 has an effect on the variance from B2. Let's just step back a minute about that. I want to just talk about going back to the case where we looked at variance of B1. That's an important quantity for the standard error because, as we showed earlier, we said B1 minus beta 1 divided by the square root of this quantity. Okay, so the square root of that. That forms our z value, and then from the z value we go to the confidence interval for beta 1. So you put it between up and lower the critical values from the t distribution, and you unpack that. So what that indicates here is that when we eventually get our confidence interval for b1, so I'm just going to call this lower bound 1 and upper bound 1. So b1, beta 1 rather, the confidence interval for the first coefficient, beta 1, varies between some lower bound and some upper bound. The second beta is also going to be between upper bound, call this upper bound 2, and lower bound 2. Okay. So this first equation, just from an interpretation point of view, tells us that those variances are variance of B1 depends on the variance of B2. The variance of B2 depends on the variance of B1. It means that when you interpret this confidence interval, you cannot look at it univariately. You can't just say this confidence interval, B1 moves between that bounding, that upper bound and lower bound, and B2 can be expected to be found between this lower bound and upper bound. Because in fact, those two confidence intervals have some sort of interaction with each other. And this is a topic that's a little bit beyond what we intend to cover in this course, but I just want to point out that in general, the equation over here implies that the relationship is quadratic. So if I had to just plot beta 1 over here and beta 2 over here, in fact, the true confidence interval is some sort of ellipse like that. And beta 1, so it says that expected pairs, so this is, say, a 95 confidence ellipse now. Now, it's a little bit complicated, but let's just step through it. It says here that 95% of the time, beta 1 and beta 2 can be found at any point inside this ellipse. So recall from, for a minute, to go back to the case where we have beta 1 between some upper bound and some lower bound 1. If you wanted to visualize that confidence interval, you would just draw a straight line and put lower bound here and upper bound here and say that region over here is my confidence interval for beta 1. So from a single variable's point of view, it's just vertical lines, a rectangle or a box. You say somewhere inside this width region, I can find beta 1. But when we have two or more variables, we don't just have boxes anymore. we now have ellipses. If we did mistakenly think that they were boxes, that would say we would just go up like this, and like this, and like this, and like this. So from B1's point of view, we've got lower bound 1, upper bound 1, and lower bound 2, and upper bound 2, and just say, this is the region within which 95% of the time we expect to find beta 1 and beta 2. But the truth is, not a box, rather it's more this elliptical shape over here. That means that you make a mistake, because what if the point is over here? From your univariate up and lower bound, you'd say this is the 95 confidence. It could be there, and it could be over there. But the truth is that it has to be inside this ellipse. Now, you may be wondering, why am I throwing up this complicated topic? Now, I just want you to kind of hold that thought in your head, because we're going to see it again in the multivariate section. This idea that variables interact, this lack of independence introduces shapes which are not squares. We can't just univariately project up the lower bounds and upper bounds from beta 1 and the upper and lower bounds from beta 2. There's a more complex relationship when variables are correlated. How is that relationship when the variables are correlated? Well, it's given over here. In particular, with just the two variable case, variance of B1 and variance of B2, here's now really where you can see how they interact. Variance of B1 is given by this formula over here. Let's take a look at just the right-hand side. Standard error squared divided by exponent squared. That's very similar to the formula we've seen before for the variance of B1. But we have this additional multiplication of 1 over 1 minus R12. R12 represents the correlation between X1 and X2. So if X1 and X2 are uncorrelated variables, they're totally independent of each other, their correlation is 0, and then this pre-multiplication term reduces down to 1. That's what you used to see. In that case, yes, then you can just project the upper and lower confidence limits, and you'll have the correct answer because R12 is 0. But the moment there's any sort of correlation between the two x variables in your model, what happens? What happens is R12 is always a positive number. It ranges between 0 and 1. So a small correlation is, say, 0.3, and a large correlation is 0.8, 0.9. What happens the moment R starts to move up from 0? What happens to the variance of B1 and the variance of B2? Right. So that's an important point here. The moment your x's, your x1 and x2, start to be correlated in any way, the variability, in other words, your confidence intervals, because this is directly related to the width of your confidence interval, starts to increase. So bear that thought in mind. You get your smallest confidence intervals possible when your x's are uncorrelated. The moment your x's start to become correlated and move up and down together with each other, those confidence regions confidence intervals for the separate coefficients, B1 and B2, start to become wider. Remember, that's undesirable. We always want the smallest confidence intervals possible. Right? So we know with the most accuracy where we can find our true slope coefficients. But the moment there's any correlation in x's, automatically that confidence interval starts to grow. And that's seen quite nicely with this representation. Okay? So that's the main thing I want you to get out of it. If you understood this elliptical concept, great. If you didn't, don't worry. But this is the key point here, that the moment our x's become correlated with each other, the confidence intervals for the individual slope coefficients, B1 and B2, start to become wider and wider. And that's undesirable.
So you realize that most of the variables correlated, so that means you have
So, right, good point. So most data is car A, you're absolutely right. So that's what the last three classes are about, is the latent variable methods, where we say we know our data is correlated. How do we deal with it? This class, we're still in the idealistic world where we're hoping our data is not correlated. We're kind of just hoping for it. But we at least we have to understand with our eyes and visually interpret this, what it means when they are correlated. The DOE section, the class after this one, for the next few classes, we intentionally make our variables uncorrelated. But then the last three classes, we say, well, in the real world, our data comes correlated to us. How do we deal with it? So excellent point. Yeah. Okay, now, the interpretation of the coefficients is a little bit different for multiple linear regression. For single variable regression, remember, the case, imagine just y equals b1 x1, okay? B1 is the change in y on average for a 1 unit increase in x. With the multiple linear regression case, you have to interpret those coefficients a little differently. What I've shown you here is what the model actually is. When y is b1 x1 plus b2 x2, we're fitting a plane to the data. We're not fitting a line to the data. We've now had gone up one dimension, we're fitting a plane. So we've got these points in the x1, x2 plane, and I've just shown where they lie relative to the plane. So you're projecting up onto this plane, some points are above, some points are below. And the least squares model just finds the tilt of that plane so that it minimizes the sum of the squares of those vertical up and down distances that I've drawn as little vertical lines. So that's what the model is doing, and it fits the data. Now we want to know, looking just from x1's point of view, so we're projecting just from this forward direction, we get the slope of the plane. What does that b1 slope mean? And looking at it sideways, just from this angle, and my perspective drawing isn't very good, but this is the best I can try. This angle B2 represents the angle of the plane when you're looking at it from this side. What does that B1 and B2 mean? So if you had to interpret B1, could you say that it's the average change in Y when you make a 1 unit increase in X? One. And B2 would be the average change in Y when you make a 1 unit increase in X2. That's what you might think, but there's an additional point. It is true, but you have to rephrase it a little carefully. The way you have to say it is that B1 represents the change in Y on average for a 1 unit increase in X, given that all the other x's are held constant. That's the only additional part. Everything else is the same. The only thing is that all the other x's are held constant. So B2 then is the effect of changing x2 by 1 unit, holding x1 constant. Okay, so the key is that you have to hold the other x's constant. There's no, otherwise it's identical interpretation. So provided we hold x2 fixed, we can say b1 is the average change in y for a 1 unit increase in x1. So let's take this example here. Y is equal to the reactor temperature in Kelvin, so that's capital T. So this is our variable T. So I'm not calling it x1 anymore, in this case at least. So T is, would be our variable, its coefficient is bt. We have the substrate concentration going into our bioreactor here with their coefficient Bs. So the effect on the yield measured in micrograms would be, say, for the Bt variable interpreted as negative 0.52 micrograms per Kelvin. So that's the decrease in yield of 0.52 micrograms for every Kelvin increase in temperature, holding the substrate concentration S fixed. That's how you interpret BT. Now, this is a good point to introduce this other type of way. People, you'll sometimes hear this, and it's common in the medical literature, but it is also increasingly common in engineering, for people to say something along this lines. They'll say, the effect of temperature controlling for concentration is not significant. So let's take a look what that means. It'll say, for example, the effect of temperature, so here this T, controlling for concentration S, is not significant. They're controlling for just means that that variable that they're controlling for, in this case we're controlling for concentration, it just means you've included concentration in your model already. And so it's kind of saying you're taking account of the variable you're controlling for. So another way to say this, the effect of temperature, taking into account the concentration effect, is not significant. So in this case, temperature does not have an effect on yield, taking concentration into account. Or let's switch it to a different variable. The effect of concentration now I'm looking at S. The effect of concentration S, controlling for temperature, is to increase the yield by 3.2 micrograms for every gram per liter increase in S. So it just says the effect beyond whatever you're controlling for. The effect of concentration, accounting for the fact that temperature is known to affect the reactor, but accounting for that, then the yield is increased. So in social sciences or in other areas, they'll say the effect of income, accounting for gender, is that engineers earn the same. So what that means is that they've taken into account the stupid disparity that still exists today, that women earn less than men. So taking that into account, you control for gender. So you sometimes hear that. So controlling for something means that you've included that variable in your model, and then you're looking at the coefficient of whatever you're interested in. So here we're interested in concentration, controlling for temperature. So just so you understand what that terminology means. Okay, so this is the one interesting section that I want to cover today still, and then hopefully there's some time for a few other topics at the end. But this one is quite common in applications we deal with, and that's integer data. So, for example, you're looking at this reactor where you know that the yield is a function of temperature in the reactor and the impeller time. I think in the notes I made the example that Y was not yield, but mixing time. But in this example here in class, I'm going to use, say, a bioreactor, and we know that the yield we get from that is a function of the temperature and the impeller time. So impeller is either radial or axial, and you collect data on both types of impellers. Now, you could go and build a model just for the radial impeller and a model just for the axial. So let's take a look how you could do that. So we've got yield is a function of V1 times temperature. And you do this just for the impeller radial. Then you go build another model, Y is V1 temperature. And this is given impeller axial. So you go build these two models, and you can calculate, well, let's call this B1R, and we'll call this B1A, just to differentiate. And you can go get a confidence interval for B1R and a confidence interval for B1A. And you'll probably find they're overlapping, because the effect of temperature on yield is likely not a function of the impeller type. Whether you've used a radial impeller or an axial impeller, you could probably going to see the same effect for temperature, okay? But how do you account for this two sets of conditions under which you've got your data from? How can you incorporate more efficiently the impeller type in your model? Because right now, you had to collect, say, 16 data points for this set of data, and maybe you've got 12 data points for this axial impeller. So you're using, in this case, you're fitting one parameter, you've got 11 degrees of freedom to estimate B1A, you've got 15 degrees of freedom to estimate BR, and you know that one way to decrease the confidence interval is by adding more and more samples. So by having to split our data in two parts, we're losing degrees of freedom. It would be more efficient to be able to combine these 16 plus 12 measurements and use all 38 of them. I think that's 38. Use all 38 of them simultaneously and estimate our standard errors, have more degrees of freedom, narrower confidence intervals, and and really estimate one slope coefficient, just affect the slope coefficient V1 regardless of impeller type. How do we do that? Well, it's simple. We just build one model like this, where we code the impeller as an integer variable, encoded as a 0 or a 1. So we now move to this case where we've got, okay, I had a V0 over here, which I didn't whatever. Let's say we are estimating an intercept. We've got the temperature effect, and then we add this integer variable. I'm going to call it gamma times D. And D is a 0 when you're using an axial impeller, and a 1 when you're using a radial impeller. So gamma, or G, the variable we estimate, is going to be an estimate of the effect of the impeller. And V1 is the effect of temperature. Does that make sense? How we code it? Let's take a look at it geometrically. Imagine initially that there is no temperature effect. Okay? So in that case, y is just equal to V0 plus 0. Y is 0 because for axial impellers, D1 or DI one is 0. So that whole term drops off. So for axial impellers, that's this case. And for radial impellers, we're estimating a model of the form Y equals V0 plus D. So geometrically, you can just visualize it as this case, where you're just measuring the V0 intercept over here. For axial impellers, the open dots, and for the closed dots, that line just shifts up. But you're fitting this all in one go. And then G just represents the amount by which the intercept increases or decreases when you change the impeller type. Okay? So that's pretty straightforward. We're now going to just we're adding basically a new term into the model. Like any multiple linear regression, you just introduce a new variable and you fit the data to that model in one go. So the key is we don't need to build a model for axial impellers and then for radial impellers. We just do it all in one shot. Now imagine that V1 is non-zero. So then we add in this additional term for temperature, but notice that V1 is the same V1. So we're saying that the slope is independent of the impeller type, slope related to temperature. And the moment we do this, all that happens is that these lines start to tilt because we're now adding the effect of temperature. But they're still parallel. That's the key thing, is that the G is just an offset in that line. So for example, if we found G to be minus 56 micrograms, the interpretation is that the average decrease in yield is 56 micrograms when using the radial impeller. Okay, so it now gives us the effect of the impeller type. And the reason why this works, the geometric trick here, contrast this picture back to this one over here. Everything's the same. We're still fitting a plane to these data points, except in this case, our x2 variable is not continuous, but in this case, our x2 variable is discrete. It's either a 0 or a 1. And all that happens is those points happen to lie for the axial impeller in front and for the radial impeller in line with the back. But there is still actually a plane that goes between them. It's just we don't use the model at those points. We just use the model at D equals 0 or at D equals 1. In the future, when we want to use the model, we have to know what x1 is. We want to predict yield knowing our temperature. And we know we've got the radial impeller in the tank. And then we can predict what the y is going to be. But we don't ask what the model prediction is going to be at 0.5, at 1.7. So it just doesn't make sense. But the model is estimated as if it were continuous. We only use it at discrete values of d. And then you can bring in all the other nice tools from least squares that you've used before, like the confidence interval, the standard error. But particularly the confidence interval in this case is quite nice. So the confidence interval for impeller might be that gamma is between minus 32 micrograms and 21 micrograms. So you would then conclude the impeller provides no significant effect on the yield. So nothing changes. Your variable is just coded in a slightly different way, but all the other tools you've used before, confidence interval, standard errors, and the way you fit the model are identical. Nothing else is different. Then I'll just cover this section and we'll take a short break. What happens if your variable of interest has more than two levels? Well, you can show that, for example, you wanted to code something that had, say the day of the week, is you wanted to know what the influence of the day of the week is. There's seven different levels. You have to introduce one fewer new variables into the model. So if there's p levels, you have to introduce p minus one new variables. So in this case, let's take a look. We've got Spain, India, and Vietnam. We want to understand what the effect of our raw material coming from one of those three countries is on some y. So we've got beta 0 plus beta 1 x1 up to beta k xk. So those are some other variables. Then for the effect of Spain, we have to introduce a gamma 1 d1 and a gamma 2 d2, where we code 0, 0 for Spain, 0, 1 for India, and 1, 1 for Vietnam. So we've got three levels, for three countries. We have to introduce two new variables, gamma 1 and gamma 2. So what's the interpretation of gamma 1, g1? If I showed you that g1 was 0.6, how would you interpret that coefficient for gamma 1? So look at gamma 1, it changes from, like the impeller example, it's the change when looking at the difference from the Spanish supplier to the Indian supplier. So it's the effect of using the Indian supplier. So gamma 1 would be increase or decrease when using the Indian supplier. Gamma 2 is a little bit harder to interpret. It's the effect on top of the Indian supplier, or sorry, beyond the Indian supplier, of using the Vietnamese supplier. So because those coefficients are really hard to interpret when you're using them in this way, you'll sometimes see this alternative coding, which just says, okay, look, I know I'm going to lose a degree of freedom, but I'm willing to give that up for much easier interpretation. So what they do then is, if you've got three levels, you introduce three new variables. If you've got seven levels, like say day of the week, you introduce seven new variables. Because that's way easier to interpret it. Because for gamma 1, you just switch that to a 1 for Spain. For gamma 2, you switch that to a 1 when you're using an Indian supply. And gamma 3, when you're using an Indian supply. Then it's way easier. Now you just have to look. Gamma 1 is the effect of using the supplier from Spain, holding all other variables constant. Gamma 2 is the effect of using the supplier from India, holding all other variables constant. And gamma 3 is the effect of using the Indian supply. Okay. So you lose a degree of freedom, but you know, like, if you're up to seven levels, day of the week, you're going to be adding six new variables to your model. Well, just add a seventh new variable and have a way easier interpretation. Okay? But the key is here, you don't have to do any new work. You just fit this in, you form your X transpose X matrix, your X transpose Y matrix, and then you calculate all these coefficients in one go. In particular, your X matrix, the first column in X, which is the X1, the second column X2, up to XK. What does this column look like? The column for Spain. It's just a whole lot of zeros and ones. So you just put zeros when you're not using the Spanish supply, and you put ones when you are using the Spanish supply in that column. And then similar column for the Vietnamese, and similar in the last column, which is in, the last column that you take in, the second US column in India. Then you've got your X matrix that way, and you've got your Y matrix, and you can create the from X transpose X, inverse X transpose Y. And I'm not going to expect you to generally formulate these problems like that, although maybe in the assignment I'll have you just do it once, but in the, I'll show you the R code where R kind of takes care of it. You just add a variable called day of the week, and it will create those columns automatically for you, fit the model, and return all the coefficients for you. So it takes care of the heavy lifting. We just have to take care of the interpretation. Okay, so let's take a 5-minute break. I made a very good slide when it came to this first model. When I said gamma 1 was the effect of India, I said that because what I had thought I had written in the slide was D0, D1 is 0 for Spain, D2 is 0 for Spain. I had thought that D1 is 1 for India, D2 is 0 for India. So had that been the case, yes, then gamma 1 is the effect of using the Indian formula. In this particular case, in fact, the way it turns out is that gamma 1 is the effect of the Indian supply, as it's written here on the screen. But when I was saying that, I had said it wrong there. But by far the easiest way to understand the coding is use the second form. And then just another point was raised here about this, is that these integer variables are mutually exclusive. Like you can't use both the Spanish and Indian supply at the same time. That doesn't make sense. For example, if this was the day of the week, it can't be the 2 days simultaneously. So in that way, so these models are interpreted that the D's, D1, D2, D3, only one of them is on at one point. You can't have two of them on at the same time. They're mutually exclusive. And then another question that was asked during the break was regarding what happens if you score more than 100%, like does it round down to 100? No, it doesn't. Everything gets carried through. So if you get 100% and take your midterm counts, so the example is, take your midterm counts, 15% of your course grade, say you've got 110%, I, on my computer, I just say 1.1 times 15, so you get additional points. It may mean that you've got some accumulated grades so that you don't have to hand in your course book, or you could use it to not hand in one of your assignments, or whatever. But the point is that it all gets carried forward. The only thing is that if you get 105 as your final grade for this course, I can't give you 105 because the university's computer system doesn't have it. But for me, I should change this. Okay, so this is the last topic. This is, that's actually quite interesting. It's the effect of outliers on the model. And I'll be introducing some tools here that you're not likely to see in any textbooks at an engineering level. But these are tools that have really become prevalent only in the last 10, 15 years. Unfortunately, the newer textbooks don't include these. But they're tremendously important in order to understand how unusual data impacts your model. And this really helps because now you can make a far more informed decision whether you should include an outlier or exclude it based on these tools. So let me show you a few examples. So unusual observations influence the model parameters. We know that if there's a big outlier, it's going to affect those parameters in some way. I'll show you a few graphical examples here. But the point is these outliers really are the most interesting data that you've probably collected. The data that falls close to your model plane, well, you know what that means. It just follows the normal pattern of the data. But outliers really should not just be deleted. You should really go and investigate them quite carefully because they could be where your process was operating really well, beyond the typical levels that you normally see. And so by understanding what's going on in that outlier, you may be able to uncover a certain case or a certain setup in your process that leads to better operation. Discarding that outlier means you have never learned more about your process. So investigating outliers really means you start to learn much more about what your system does. If you just look at the slopes and so on, you're learning nothing more than is already in the average of the data. An outlier is also obviously from quite poor operation, so then you can go investigate why it happened and then choose to remove it from your model. But the point here is don't just see outliers and click and delete them. Really go and investigate your carefully before you overcome. You may also find that outliers indicate that you've got some sort of missing variable in your model. Outliers, like for example, that model where I had the Cadillacs, the convertible Cadillacs. Those points were outliers and we excluded them. But what if we included a new variable, an indicator variable, maybe for convertibles, and then those points don't become outliers anymore because now there's a variable in the model that helps to explain them. So it can indicate that you've got some sort of missing X variable in the model and can help you improve your model actually. But on the other hand, don't just go and add a variable for Cadillacs, yes or no, add a variable for convertibles, yes or no. Just indiscriminately add new variables. Because what happens is if you start to overfit the data. I'll talk a little bit about that at the end, hopefully some time. But the key relationship I want to use in this section at least is that for unusual data points, there's this concept, the influence on the model is a product of the leverage and a product and discrepancy. So it's a point is unusual when it's both unleveraged and when it's got a large discrepancy. So let's take a look at what these terms mean. Leverage is quite easy to understand. So it's the principle of a lever, a point operating far away from the center of the model has high leverage. So here I've got two models. Here, model A, I'm looking at the point marked with the square. It is a point that's roughly in the center of the data set. And the black line, the solid black line is an indication where the model slope would be when you use all the data. The dashed line just below it is the same model slope obtained when you omit that square point. So by deleting that outlier, the slope hasn't changed much. Let's take a look at model B. Again, a set of X variables, but there's this outlier over here. The black slope, the solid black line one, is the model using all the data. Notice how that point pulls the line towards it. It has to because the objective function says minimize the sum of the square errors. So by doing that, by using that objective function, it's natural that the slope determinant pulls towards it because it's trying to minimize that distance, the vertical distance, from the square up to the model plane. The dashed line, on the other hand, is the refit of the data once the square has been omitted. So the slope changes. And that could be important in some cases where the slope is some meaning to you. Outliers in your data would lead you to misinterpret the effect of X on Y. So in this first case, omitting the outlier has no real effect. You probably would not make any significant misinterpretation. In the second case here though, keeping that square point in can quite dramatically distort the slope. I mean, there's cases where I've seen in many real data sets something like this. You quickly notice it though, where you see this and then the point is here. You have an outlier over here. And then the best fit line is that. The least squares fit is obviously that, which is nonsensical. If you don't omit that point, then you get that as your least fit line. So you could even get the wrong sign of the slope in very extreme cases over here. In this case, you're still getting the same sign, but the slope is obviously a different magnitude. So this is in a very extreme case, but the point I want to make here is, what is leverage? this point over here has low leverage. It has little effect on the model, or little influence. Whereas this point over here has quite some leverage. It's able to pull or lever the model towards itself. This model is tilts on the average. So this point over there, this is the model, average X bar, Y bar. The regression slopes always pass through that. So that point is able to leverage it to pull the model slope towards itself. How do we quantify leverage? We do it by using what's called this hat value, and I'm not going to derive what the hat value is, other than to say here, it means roughly how far the data point is from the center of the model. So you can see that in the numerator there, x minus x bar squared. But the denominator kind of takes care of the correlation structure in the data. So I don't want to get into that too much, other than to point out the reason why this previous model had low leverage was because it's close to the center of the model. X bar is somewhere over here. So X minus X bar for this point is a small number. It has low leverage. X minus X bar is this distance over here from left, from 25 to 15. So that has a higher leverage. So its hat value is much higher. If you look at the hat values, I've plotted them in sequence order here. So each x variable has a hat value. Here's the hat value for that square point for model A. For model B, the second model, the hat value is up there. Now, we can calculate theoretically the average hat value, h bar, is just given by k over n. And you can look and inspect that equation and prove to yourself that the smallest hat value possible is 1 over n. That's kind of why you see it's as if there's a bottom over here. Points can't go lower than that. 1 over n is your lowest possible hat value. Your largest possible hat value is 1. So the range of hat values is between those two limits. And we typically plot h bar over here, 2h bar, or 3h bars. And 3h points beyond 3 average hat values are usually considered to have some influence or leverage on the model. That would be a point worth investigating, I'd say. This point that's kind of just beyond 2h bar, maybe, but definitely this point is a large hat value.
For the first part, let's say you pose circular points above the center line. Those don't look like outliers, right? But what if you take them out, would that make a graph look different?
Okay, so that's exactly what we're investigating in. Yeah, you could go and go remove them and rebuild the model. All this indicates to you is that beyond 2 hat values, you can maybe start to become interested in these points. Beyond 3 hat values, if they definitely have some influence on the model. But we're going to see in the next slide that influence on the model, like the ability to pull the slope towards itself, is not just a function of the leverage. It's also a function of discrepancy. Discrepancy, you can interpret as being a point that's unusual in the context of the model. Okay? So a discrepant point, you could say, is just really like a point with a large residual. This point has large discrepancy. This point also has large discrepancy. What I mean by that is, look at x. In terms of the square point, that square point over here, in terms of the range of x, it goes from 5 to 20. That point really, from x perspective, is not very different. From the y perspective, 20 up to 70, it's kind of at the high end, but it's also within the range of y's. But a discrepant point is one that's unusual in the context of the regression. So, in this case, in the context of the regression, that square point is unusual. Unusual therefore in the context of the least squares model is a discrepant point. And the way we measure that, one, we could use just the residual as a measure of discrepancy. But because the residuals, like this point over here, it pulls the model towards itself. Imagine in this case, the residual is very small. Because it pulled the whole regression slope towards itself, it's going to have a small residual. Yet, you kind of think this is discrepant, like this has some sort of influence on the model. So, discrepancy cannot be modeled purely by the residual EI. Okay, you can't just use that as a measure of discrepancy, because very large inferential points can pull the model towards itself. We need a better measure of discrepancy, not just the residual. And the way we do that is by taking the residual EI, but we divide it through by the hat value. So point with a large hat value, we're going to say 1 minus that, so that's going to be a small number, so we're going to inflate this EI star. So points with large hat values will get lower, this EI values. And we'll also divide it through by the standard error minus I. That means the SE minus I is what the standard error would have been when that I point was removed from the model. Okay? So think a bit about that. It says, take this model over here, delete the square points, and refit the standard error. That's SE subscript minus I. In this case, you can imagine what SE minus I would be for this data point. The standard error with this point in the model is whatever it is, because it's pulled the model towards itself. But if I delete this point from the model and then fit that, now the standard error is going to be huge, because this point is, that's going to be the residual distance. So SE is going to be really inflated. So this is one way to make discrepant points really stand out, is by reformulating this new EI, and it's called studentized residuals. So you might see this in software packages, for example, that are called the studentized residuals. It's a residual that has been scaled to account for its leverage and for its ability to pull the model towards itself. And when we plot these studentized residuals, which if there's nothing wrong with the model, will kind of look just like ordinary residuals. But studentized residuals will make these unusual points really stand out. So for that first model, it has a very large studentized residual. So the points over here are typically around zero. And I haven't indicated it on this plot, but typical limits for studentized residuals are plus or minus 2. They come from student's t value. That plus or minus 2 t values are significant, or contain 95% of the data. So this point is very, very significant from the studentized residual point of view. In that second model, B, which I don't have here, I do have model B here, this was this one. So this is model B. Again, its studentized residual is a large negative value. So it's negative because once you delete that point, here's y hat minus y. So it's a negative value. So the studentized residual is a very large negative. Then for model C, which I don't have here in my slides, but you have it in the notes in front of you, the studentized residual for that point is over here. It's within the plus or minus 2 limits. Okay. So these studentized residuals are a good way of checking discrepancy. So coming back to this formula over here, we've looked at what leverage is. Leverage is the ability of a point, or how far it is from the center. And discrepancy is how far away it is from the least squared model, but accounting for its ability to leverage itself. And the combination of that is how influential that point is. Okay, but let's just take a look at influence. We could just take the product of the two, and there is a statistic, it's called Cook's DI, which sort of does that in a slightly different way. But the way you can see it is, influence can be quantified as the effect. Each point has an influence. So the influence of a point would be the effect of removing it from the model. And one way to quantify it, and it's you can see it like this conceptually, in fact you can see it like this even mathematically and get to the same result here. But you can imagine if I fit B1 with all the data, and then I fit my model again and I calculate B1, omitting the ith data point. So if we're looking at a data point of interest, I fit the model, I get a slope, I remove that ith point from the data set, I refit the model, and I get a different slope. The influence is the difference of that. and then it accounts for degrees of freedom and uses a fancy F-test to rescale it. But basically, inference is by how much the model changes when you omit a particular And if you use this concept over here, you can get to what you could derive the statistic, which is a product of discrepancy. So here you see that concept of discrepancy and a product of leverage. And typical values are below this DI of 4 divided by n minus k. So anything beyond that is considered an influential point. So taking a look at the plots of influence then, that first model has a color is over here, and its cos d is 0.4. The second model, B, has a very highly influential point. And then the third model, it's just beyond the title for the day. So the reason why the first model has slightly high influence is because it's discrepant. So given that influence is a product of discrepancy and leverage, it doesn't have large leverage. We know that it's close to the center of the model, but it's because it has some discrepancy. In the second model, this point has both high leverage and high discrepancy. So high leverage because it's far away from the center of the model, and high discrepancy because it's far away from that least squares line. So the combination of both of those things lead it to having a very large influence, far, far higher than the cutoff value. And then model C, which I don't have illustrated here in my notes, but you do have it in yours, shows you that this point is kind of just at the cutoff value. In fact, the one in the notes, for those of you that didn't have it printed out, it's a model that looks like this, where there's a straight line and there's points kind of here, and then the square point is over here. So it is influential because it's far away from the center of the model. So here's x bar. So it's influential, but it's not. So it's got a high leverage. Sorry, it's got high leverage, but it's not got a high discrepancy because it fits very close to the model. Whether you keep that point in the model or remove it from the model, you're going to get very little change in the model coefficient. So B1 minus B1 without that point, that difference is going to be quite small. So it doesn't have a large influence. In fact, there's another data point in the model that has a slightly higher influence. And you can go figure out which one it is. Now, you can combine all three of these measures, influence, discrepancy, and leverage, into one plot. So kind of in that first class where I showed you where the guy was able to fit 5 dimensions onto a page, here we're fitting 3 dimensions onto a page. Let's unpack this a little bit. So here's model A and C. Let's just take a look at model A. What we're showing here on the x-axis is the hat value, so in other words, the leverage. On the y-axis, we're showing the discrepancy for the student size residual. So values are above and below 0, and there's our plus 2 cutoff. And then in circles, we show the influence. And the radius of the circle is proportional to the influence. So going just stepping around back, the circles are proportional to the values shown on the y-axis. So for example, these points would have a radius that's very small. This point has a radius of 0.4, some larger. So the point is you show the circle whose diameter or radius is proportional to its regular reference. Now very quickly, you can locate on this plot then, which are the influential points. So influence, the size of that circle, is a product of the quantity shown on the x-axis and the quantity shown on the y-axis. So the product of those two gives you an idea of influence. And you can immediately see how point number 10 is unusual. And then you can make a decision. Well, you see, it has large influence, but it's not due to its hat value. It's not highly leveraged. It's only because it's discrepant. So you know, just by looking at this plot, by deleting that point up there in the red, it's not going to have a strong effect on the model by deleting it. So loan's not going to change a whole lot because it's not highly leveraged. It's only just because it's got a large discrepancy or a high student amortized residual. In the second plot, the second model, the hack value indicates that it's highly leveraged. It's outside, this is the one hack value average, and this is the two hack value average, or maybe this is two and that's three, I'm not 100% sure. But, anyway, it's well beyond the limits, so that's H bar three. It's well beyond that limit from the leverage perspective. On the y-axis, those horizontal lines indicate the plus or minus two standard deviations of the residuals. It's got a very high discrepancy. And then thirdly, its radius is large, so it's influential. So it really meets all three criteria. And then the last plot, you can interpret it in much the same way. Except this point here is not that square. I believe the hat value, no, it is, yeah, it's 0.3. So this point over here, 0.3 something, this is due to the square point, but these other large circles are due to some of the other data points that were in the model. So this is actually that square point that I originally had in mind. The influence plot function in R, you have to first import the car library, build your model, and then you just pass your model into this influence plot function. In fact, the moment you type that, it then changes your cursor so that you can go click on the points and it will label them for you. So you type influence plot and it will draw this for you. And then you just click on that red point and it will say that's point 16. Or, you can pass an extra parameter into this so that it might, doesn't just show point 16, but it will label it with the actual labels. It might be that this is from a certain time in the process, or it might be a particular observation name. So then you can go helpfully label these plots and you can interpret it easier. Okay, but I like these because it combines all three of those concepts of leverage, influence, and discrepancy, and leaves you in a position to much better decide now whether you should include that outlier or not. And then there's plots which are a bit beyond what we're going to go cover here. What happens when two or three points are jointly influential? So you might have a case where you have this, and your general slope is like that, with points above and below. You have a point over here, and a point over here. So those two points are they kind of balance each other out, because the one is pulling it the one way, and the other is pulling it the other way. You won't really pick that up too much. You'll pick it up on certainly the discrepancy, but you won't pick it up on the influential point. So when you get more than one data point that becomes jointly influential, there's things called added variable plots and component plus residual plots, which we won't cover in this course. But just to point out, this is good for picking out the effect of one or two unusual observations, but when you have groups of observations, then you really need some additional tools if you want to improve things. Okay, then just to point out in the notes, there's a few extra pages. I've said that they're for enrichment. There is one topic, though, that I want to cover here in the last few minutes that I will not consider enrichment. I will consider it as part of the course. But for the other topics here, robust least squares are, that's the same idea as robustness. It's how to build a least squares model that is not influenced by outliers. Usually you'll go in and look at your model once you've built it and understand what's going on. But in some cases, like when you're building the model automatically, or the person reviewing the model is not trained in understanding these plots, you might want to use robust least squares. Well, what happens in the case when your y variable is yes or no? So now you want to build a model where y is going to be fail or pass. So you predict whether this batch is going to pass or fail based just on the raw materials. So your x data are the properties of the raw material, the operator, the humidity, the ambient temperature, and you want to predict a yes or no decision before you even run the batch, that the batch is going to pass or fail. If you can successfully do that, you don't need to waste the money and time to actually run the batch, and then only to find out it fails and yet discard its material. So these models are very, very powerful. I've used them quite a lot for some industrial processes. But again, what happens here is you can't just naively, like we've done for the X data, where we've got yes or no, you cannot just go and put in Y as 1 or 0 and just build your linear model. Because what happens if you predict Y hat as 1.2, or you predict the Y of 1.0.7? It doesn't kind of work that way. So how can you deal with the searches on the page or so on that note? But this section here on testing, I do consider this as important. So this is section 14.3. And if you think just a bit what the objectives of building these linear models are, you're not just doing it to get a prediction. You're often doing it to learn more about your process. So what is the effect of one variable on another? Use the confidence interval to verify that's a significant effect. But when you do come to using a model purely for prediction, now you're interested in how well does it work and how do we test that? It's not good enough just to look at the standard error, or some people use the R-squared value to judge that. That's a meaningless number to you to make that decision. The really only way to verify a model's performance for future use is to have an independent testing data set that matches the future use scenario. Let's take a look at that. So you have an independent testing data set, you've built your model, then you bring your independent X variables in, you use them in the model, you get predicted Y, and you compare them to the Ys. Okay, so what I mean by that is, let's take in a new X, we get a new Y hat. So bring in a new X, you get a new Y hat from using that model. Subtract the known Y. Okay. So what this means then, when you build your model, let's just take the simplest case where y is equal to b0 plus b1 x1, that you have a new testing data set where you've got x1 mu and y. Okay. You just bring those x's in, plug them into this model, you'll get a y hat. Okay. And so then you can add a third column here as the Y predictor. What we're comparing is how did that prediction compare to the Y that you know it should have been predicting. Okay? So you're testing data set is both the X and Y. Then you compare the predicted Ys to the known Ys. Subtract the two for the sum of squares and you calculate the average. So you divide by n. And that's called the root mean square error of prediction. So it's the squared error of prediction, and it's the root mean because you take the square root of the mean and have the sum of these squares. So root mean squared error of prediction. Now, you've already seen that for the training the model, or when you build the model, we'll call that the RMSE, root mean squared error of estimation. In that case, this is calculated in exactly the same way, but it uses the x and y vector that you use to build your models. But RMSEP is totally new data that you've never used to build your model. RMSEE is very similar to the standard error. The only difference is that standard error divides by n minus k. Or you could use some other measure of process, whatever is applicable in the process. But generally, RMSEP is one good way to quantify on the prediction areas. And also, RMSEP has the same units as Y. So Y is measured in as yield in milligrams, then RMSEP is also. Now, just to finish up here, given these two examples, let's take a look at this example with two cases. So we need to build a predictive model for viscosity using three X variables. So it's some hypothetical case. And we have these data available. Once per day, you have the three X's and the Y available. So you've got data from 2006 and 2007. So about 730 observations. Which situation would you prefer to use, A or B? In A, you're using operation 1, 3, 5, 7, so on. You're using your hard data to build your model, and then you use your even data, 2, 4, 6, and so on, to test your model. So you use your hard to build, and then you use your even data to calculate this number, RMS and P. Okay? And then from then you judge how the model works. Or case B, do you use observations from 2006 and then test them on the data from 2007? It's important to always test our data on something totally new you've never seen before. So when we build our model, it doesn't know about observations that are unknown. It only knows about the even data. In this case, it doesn't know about the data from 2007. We're only using data from 2006. Both cases, we're doing the right thing. We're using testing data to verify our model. But which case is better?
I'd make a guess for B because it's more now really predicting the future kind of thing.
Exactly. You'll often see that where people might use system A. They'll use every second observation to build and then every other observation to test. But it's really, when your data are ordered in time, it's not appropriate to do that. Because you're going to kind of fool yourself. You're going to get pretty good predictions. This case, like you said, then, is more realistic. It's closer to the truth, the way that you're going to use this model in the future. So both cases you're using a testing data set that's good, but in this case, it's better to use a testing data set that more realistically mimics the real usage case in the future. Okay? So I'll maybe include in the assignment a question on training and testing for you to get a feel for how to bring in new data and test your model with it. But to me, this topic is tremendously important, and it's one that's often overlooked in real modeling, or if it's done, it's done really poorly. Then the last thing is, I will put these slides on the web for the 600 level students to please go through the section on bootstrapping and what that means. It's just 2 plus slides, but it is in the printer. Okay. Thanks, everyone.